Hey everybody, welcome to Altium Academy. I am your host, Zach Peterson, also a technical consultant for Altium. And today we're gonna be talking about component tolerances because this is something that we actually can include in simulations when we want to evaluate circuit behavior. So what causes component tolerances and how big can they actually get? And finally, how can you actually quantify these for use in a circuit simulation? That's what we're gonna look at today. Let's go ahead and get started. Okay, so what are component tolerances? Well, if you've ever been on a search engine like Octopart and you're looking for resistors or capacitors or anything like that, as you scroll through the list of search results, what you will generally see is you will see a percentage associated with one of those search results. That percentage that you see in the search results entry is the tolerance on that particular value for that component. So just as an example, if we have a resistor and let's say it has a resistance of R ohms, the real resistance, if you were to just pick up this resistor out of a bucket of resistors and measure it randomly, is not going to be exactly R, it's going to be plus or minus some tolerance value. And that tolerance value could be 5%, which is pretty common, could be 10%, or it could be a very precise resistor like 1% or even as low as 0.1%. So, doesn't just apply to resistors, capacitors, inductors. All the passives will have some component tolerances associated with them. And so when you're on a search engine like Octopart and you're searching for components, there will actually be a search filter that you can use to narrow down to specific tolerances within that group of passives. So it's a pretty easy way to look for passives that have a very specific tolerance if you need a very precise passive for a particular device. So general purpose is usually going to be like the 5 for 10% level. However, let's say in the case of a resistor, let's say you're doing something very precise, like for example, with a current sense resistor that needs very precise measurement so that you can get very precise regulation in maybe a switching regulator, then you would actually want something much more precise like 1% or even 0.1%. So some components, they have very tight levels of tolerance, and that is because they are being marketed for very precise applications. Now, generally, when a resistor or a capacitor or any other component comes off the line, they don't actually design it to have a tolerance. There's always gonna be some variations in the manufacturing process and in the material properties that are used to make these components. And what they will do is they will test them in batches, and then they will group the 5% and 10% group in one area, they will group the 1%, 0.1% group in another area, they'll package them differently, give them different part numbers, and then they will go ahead and sell those on the market. And that is all due to variations in the manufacturing process and the materials. Doesn't just apply to resistors, capacitors, inductors, same kind of thing. They get tested and then they get separated and then that is how they get packaged in different part numbers and sold on the market as different tolerances. Now, if you're looking in a component data sheet, like let's say for example, an integrated circuit, maybe it's a voltage regulator, maybe it's just a transistor, whatever it may be. If you're looking through a data sheet and you scroll down to some of the specifications, the electrical specifications table, you will actually see minimum and maximum values for those different specifications. And they don't actually specify that particular tolerance using a percentage. So it's actually quite common just for passives to have their specifications given in terms of a percentage, whereas like with an integrated circuit, they will give a variation within some range. That is either because the component will not operate above or below some range, but also because there are variations in the process that produce some variation in that specification that you see in that table. So it's a little bit of a mix with integrated circuits. That's why with integrated circuits, you generally don't see a percentage being used to define a component tolerance. So I mentioned one application with power where component tolerances are important, but they're important in other applications too. So a great example is like with filtering. And this is something I've had to recently deal with on an analog board on a client project, and I'll just kind of show you what I mean. In one example here with a filter, if we're looking at the transfer function, let's say it's a low pass filter. And so the transfer function magnitude basically looks something like this. Well, if we need to have very precise cutoff at a certain frequency right here, at this value, F, then we need to make sure that component tolerances don't cause this roll-off to vary too much. Because if we look at the equation for the cutoff frequency for this particular filter, that will depend on the component values. And whatever component values we have in the circuit, those tolerances will cause those values to vary. So it also means that this frequency will vary a little bit. So for one circuit that you actually build and test, this might look like the roll-off in the transfer function, but another circuit may look something like this. And then another one may look something like this. And so this is all an important part of reliability analysis and component selection, because if this is too big of a roll-off, meaning if this 3 dB frequency right here is too big, then you need to select components that have much tighter tolerances. And that's going to decrease this variation between these curves and this transfer function so that they are closely aligned to this theoretical curve to which you've designed the circuit. So this is just an example from a simple analog application, but it is important in precision analog applications where you need to get like a very precise measurement, or you require some minimum level of roll-off for a certain set of frequencies above some value. So selecting component tolerances is all about ensuring you get some minimum level of variation that you need in your particular circuit. Normally, if you're going to investigate how the tolerances and all of the components for this circuit create this variation in whatever output quantity it is you want to measure, you wouldn't necessarily be able to build enough circuits in order to get statistically meaningful results for this variation that you care about. So what I mean by that is, if you were to actually do this through measurement, you would have to build a lot of test circuits. So you'd have to buy all the components, you'd have to send them off for fabrication and assembly, you'd get it all assembled into boards, you'd get your boards back, and then you'd have to go through and test it manually. Then you'd have to plot out all of this data, you'd have to analyze it statistically, and then you could make some statement as to whether or not this variation is close enough to the true variation in the circuit, and then make a judgment as to whether or not that is something you can accept with your component tolerances. So instead of doing this manually through testing and building a bunch of test circuits, we do this through simulation. And so in a simulation, you can actually account for the component tolerances in your simulation, either directly with some simulation programs, or what you might have to do is actually calculate an intermediate statistical quantity, and then you have to use that in the simulation in order to define component tolerances and determine how they will affect the circuits. We're gonna look at what you need to do in a SPICE simulation in order to account for component tolerances in an upcoming video, but some simulation programs don't allow you to just enter in, say, the 5% or the 10% value or whatever it is for your components directly into the simulation program. You have to actually calculate something else first, so let's take a look at that. Now what we wanna do is just look at how we need to analyze a tolerance statistically. So a component tolerance that you see from a data sheet or from an entry in a search engine result is not necessarily going to be the same as the standard deviation. So I bring up standard deviation because component tolerance is a statistical quantity, but we need to relate it back to the formal statistical quantities that you would actually use in some simulation software. What I'm drawing here is roughly a Gaussian distribution. And this Gaussian distribution tells you the probability that the component value V takes some value along this range. And here we have the mean, or mu, if you're familiar with normal distributions. And then here we have our maximum value where we get our mean. Okay, so this is our maximum probability. So the most likely value for your component value is going to be right here at the mean. And this is the nominal value that you're gonna see from a search engine result. So let's just say, for example, you're searching for a 100 ohm resistor. That 100 ohms is gonna be the mean right here. So what is the tolerance? Where does the tolerance fit into all of this? Well, the tolerance essentially tells you the percentage of randomly sampled components that fall within a certain range here of values. So here we have V plus 5% of the nominal value, and then here we have V minus 5% of the nominal value. Let's just assume for a moment that we're dealing with like a 5% tolerance component, so like a 5% resistor. This is where these values would sit. What this means is that this distance from the mean over to here is just about 2 standard deviations. So if we know that our component, let's say in this case it's a 5% resistor, it has 5% variation, then 2 sigma is just going to be 5% in this case. So our sigma, or our standard deviation in the component values, is going to be 0.05 divided by 2, or 0.025. So why do we need this? Well, we need this because some simulation programs like LTSpice actually force you to enter this value and this value when you are setting up a Monte Carlo simulation so that you can experiment and see how these random variations in component values produce random variations on the output from your circuits, as well as various other circuit quantities that you care about in the actual circuit itself. Because it's forcing you to enter this value, what it's actually going to ask you to do is enter something like Gauss for Gaussian distribution, and then whatever the mean is, and then the standard deviation, and then there's usually some other parameters in here. So the point here is you're going to have to actually calculate this manually using the tolerance value and get to the standard deviation. So keep that in mind. In some simulation programs, you don't just enter in the 5%, you have to actually take it and divide it by 2. The 2 here is just an approximation because it really depends on how much data the manufacturer used to get that 5% number. So if they used an infinite number of components or an infinite number of test measurements in order to quantify this tolerance value, this is going to be 2. This distance here is actually going to be 1.96 sigma. So just slightly less than 2. In general, we can use 2 as a decent approximation in order to convert a tolerance value, in this example it's 5%, over to a standard deviation value. And in this case, we're just taking it and dividing it by 2 in order to determine this statistical quantity. How is this statistical quantity used in the Monte Carlo simulation? Well, what your computer is going to do is it's actually going to use the mean and then this standard deviation to randomly generate component values. And those randomly generated component values can be used to mimic what would happen if you just picked up components at random that had these tolerances. And then it can generate circuit simulation results for you using the standard SPICE simulator. You can look at all of those different results and overlay them on each other. And then you can really see how the behavior of your circuit varies just by randomly generating a bunch of component values. So that's essentially what a Monte Carlo simulation does, especially in a SPICE simulation. Now, we've been talking about this in terms of electronic component tolerances, but Monte Carlo simulations are kind of a universal type of simulation. They're not just used in SPICE simulations. They are used in all sorts of other areas of science and engineering, and I think it's important to understand just generally how this process works. Make sure you subscribe, hit the like button, hit that subscribe button to make sure that you can see the Monte Carlo simulation video that's going to be coming out soon. All right, thanks everybody, and on this one, don't forget to call your component manufacturer. See you, everybody.